Are glad to be able to gather and worship together. I know we have several folks that join us online, and we certainly appreciate all of you joining us online as well. This is our first worship service of the new year. Happy New Year. As we get started this morning, I do have a few updates to our prayer request list. Caitlin Kegel is continuing to deal with some medical issues and has asked for our prayers. Please remember her in your prayers. And we want to extend our sympathy to the following families, to Leland Steely and his family on the loss of Leland's father, Walter Lee Steely. And also to Karen Shockley and Regina Taylor and their families and the loss of their brother, Greg Belt. So please continue to remember those families in your prayers. I do have a couple of notes that I've been asked to read. This one says, "Dear church family, we'd like to express our gratitude for all the texts, phone calls, and prayers during our COVID recovery. Thank you to Josh and Emily for providing us with an amazing meal during our quarantine. We have a wonderful church family, and we appreciate it all. In Christian love, Courtney Onan and Mike Green." Also here, it says, "Dear church family, thank you all for your kind and supportive texts, phone calls, cards during Daddy's illness and passing. The spray was beautiful and we very much appreciated at the funeral home. Special thanks to David and Josh for traveling to Murray and being with us. In Christian love, the Steelys, Leland, Mary, Sarah Catherine, and Walter." And lastly, this one says, "We'd like to thank the women of Worth and their delivery elves for remembering us with a goodie basket. Even more than the tasty treats, we're especially appreciative for the thoughts and well wishes. In Christian love, Mike and Sharon Kaufman." So we are grateful for all the folks who continue to keep up the ministry of the church. Even as we're not able to do everything we'd like to gathered, we can still continue to take care of each other. Leading us in our worship service this morning, Carl Dawson has our opening prayer. Brandon Bridges is our song leader. Josh Terry has our Lord's Supper devotional. Micah Busby will be reading scripture. I'll have our sermon, and Rodney Newton has our closing prayer. If there's nothing further, Brandon, let's begin our worship then.
The joy of the Lord will be my strength. I will not falter, I will not faint. He is my shepherd, I am not afraid. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord will be my strength. All of my days, I am surrounded by mercy and grace. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord. Strength. I will not waver, walking my faith. He will be strong to deliver me safe. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength.
Bow with me, please. My dear Heavenly Father, we're thankful for this day that you've given us and all the many blessings. We're thankful for this first Sunday of the new year that we can come together in person and worship you in truth and in spirit. We're mindful of those that have lost loved ones here recently, especially Leland and his family, the Steely family and the Belt family, and ask that you comfort them as only you can at this time. We're mindful of those who are sick and have had the COVID virus, and that you would strengthen them and heal them all if it be thy will. And we're thankful for the vaccines that have come out that hopefully can cure this disease, and we can get our all lives back to normal best as we can. We are especially thankful for David and Heather and their family, and Josh and Emily and their families, and they work here with us on a daily basis, and ask that you give them a long and useful life in thy service. We're very appreciative of everyone who takes part in our services and who works to get everything done in a timely manner here, and many, many people work behind the scenes to get things done, and we're very appreciative of each and every one. We ask that you be with those who may be traveling and give them safe trip to and from their destinations. And we ask that you be with us all as we go through this new year and help us all read and study and come closer to thee. All these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Sweetly, Lord, have we heard thee calling, come, follow me. And we see where thy footprints falling lead us to thee. Footprints of Jesus that make the pathway glow. We will follow the steps of Jesus wherever they go. Though they lead o'er the cold, dark mountain seeking his sheep, or along by Siloam's fountains helping the weak. Footprints of Jesus that make the pathway glow. We will follow the steps of Jesus wherever they go. If they lead through the temple holy, preaching the word, or in homes of the poor and lowly serving the Lord. Footprints of Jesus that make the pathway glow. We will follow the steps of Jesus wherever they go. By and by through the shining portals turning our feet, we shall walk with the glad immortals heaven's golden street. Footprints of Jesus that make the pathway glow. We will follow the steps of Jesus wherever they go.
As we prepare our minds for the Lord's Supper, let us remember what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 11:28. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. The reason I picked this particular passage is because this word examine, the emphasis is mine. Paul didn't actually bold that. I don't know if you knew that. But the word examine here means to look at, to study, to decipher. And as we look at ourselves, and this is the first Sunday of the year, we take an evaluation of where we are spiritually. And every Sunday, we use this time to just take a little check and say, hey, where am I in my Christian walk? Jesus, whenever he's talking about the cost of discipleship, he says, for whoever desiring to build a tower does not first sit down and count the cost, whether he has enough to complete it. Otherwise, when he laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it begin to mock him, saying, this man began to build, but was not able to finish. As we look at our lives, we need to look back and look at what's sitting there. For my father, he bought a tractor, and he was going to fix his tractor up. And it sits in our yard to this day, and it has been, I'm 27, so it has been 13 years sitting in our yard, disassembled, needing to be fixed. Is your Christian walk like that tractor? Is it just sitting there, needing to be fixed, needing to be put back together? Let us examine ourselves as we partake of this bread. So go ahead and be peeling back that top layer, and we'll have a prayer. Father God, we thank you so much for today. Thank you for the blessing that is your Son, who came and gave us the opportunity to be with you, who made this pathway. God, as we partake of this bread, which to us Christians represents his body, may we do so in a manner that's pleasing in your sight. Son's name that we pray. Amen. At this time, we'll go ahead and have a prayer for our... So go ahead and be peeling back that second layer. Let's go to God in prayer. Father in heaven, God, I pray that we have counted the cost and we know what it means to be your disciple, to be someone that follows after you. As we partake of this blood, which gives us that opportunity, as it cleans us and makes us new, let us remember the sacrifice of Jesus on that cross. We ask all these things in your Son's name. Amen. A bag should be seated in the pew next to you. Go ahead and be depositing your garbage in there. Make easier cleanup. That concludes our Lord's Supper. But as a matter of convenience, we now have the opportunity to give back. And the work that goes on here is still going on. Even in COVID, we're still trying to reach people and help them. We're still trying to be good stewards of the money that's been provided. So let's go ahead and have a prayer for the offering. Father in heaven, God, as we give back to the works that are going on here, we pray that the money that we give can be used to continue to further your gospel. God, we pray that we can help others that are in need that do not know you yet, Lord. We ask all these things in your Son's name. Amen.
There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one. None else could heal all our souls' diseases. No, not one.
Our scripture reading this morning will be from Luke chapter 15, verses 4 through 6. What man of you, having 100 sheep, if he loses one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after the one which is lost until he finds it? And when he has found it, he lays on it his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, "Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost."
Thank you, Micah, for reading that. Thank you for being here, whether you are gathered with us in person or gathered digitally. We are glad to come together and to worship. It is a new year. I hope you've already jumped in on our Bible reading plan this year. We're going through the book of Proverbs in the month of January. We'll do several shorter Bible reading plans and just do a chapter a day. And if you prefer to have somebody kind of read along with you or somebody to follow along with, Josh and I will be recording videos where we publish, put those out every day with us reading the chapter. You can click on those. You can read it on your own. We just want to spend time in God's Word this year. King's Copy was really good for us, and I did not realize just how many folks beyond this congregation followed along with us on King's Copy. I've heard from several of them, and we're going to make sure that we keep them in the loop about our Bible reading plan as well. It's just one of the ways that this church reaches out beyond our physical footprint, and I am thankful for that. It is a new year. We're going to focus some on discipleship and what we can do to grow this year as Christians and work hard on our own faith. But none of that matters if you don't get the foundation right. And so we're going to take some time as we get started in this new year and really lay a solid foundation for working hard for the Lord, because it's easy for that to get off track and me to get really proud or me to feel really depressed because I don't do enough or really think, hey, I do a whole lot more than everybody else. And I can get messed up in my work for the Lord if I don't have the right foundation. 2020 seems to be a lot of folks have called it a lost year, especially as we talk about our school kids. And maybe that's true. We'll see what comes out of it. I know a lot of folks have been through a lot tougher things and have come out on top of it. But we've talked a lot about what we lost this year, a lost year of education, lost wages, a lost job, lost relationships. We've lost loved ones. We lost progress. We lost hugs and touch. We lost our sense of safety and peace. As a world, as a community, we lost so much. And personally, some of you lost a lot as well. And when you look up the word lost, Webster tells us that lost means not made use of, not won, not claimed. And you talk about lost opportunities. And man, January of 2020, we had some plans, and those plans were lost, some of them. You know, we didn't get a chance to make use of those plans. We also say, you know what, I lost my glasses or I lost my keys. And we say, you know what, those are no longer visible. I don't know where I put them. They're no longer known. Maybe I lost it and it's gone. It's no longer possessed at all. We know what it feels like to lose things, but do you know what it feels like to be lost? To maybe you say, you know what, I feel no longer visible. I don't know if anybody even sees what's going on. What do I do when I feel lost, when I feel like nobody even knows what's going on? When I feel no longer possessed, I don't know where I belong. I don't know where I fit in. I just feel lost. Jesus speaks to a group of people in our text this morning. And if you feel lost, if you know what it feels like to have that lost feeling, then Luke 15 is for you. Listen to his words. And maybe this morning, if I say, hey, do you know what it feels like to be lost? And you say, yeah, I know what it felt like. And I'm so glad to be found. I'm so glad I'm not lost anymore. Then I want you to look at his heart for lost people and copy it. Because here's the message that we're just going to pound home for the next couple of weeks. God loves you. It all starts right there. If we start anywhere else, we'll mess up. It all begins with the knowledge that God loves you. In Luke 15, what I think is one of the greatest set of parables that Jesus ever told, that's my opinion, you're welcome to disagree. But it all begins with a simple fact. Right there at the beginning, it says, all the tax collectors and the sinners drew near to him to hear him. And the Pharisees and scribes complained, saying, this man receives sinners and eats with them. Kind of like Josh, I'm going to point out, Luke didn't write that in yellow and underline it. I did, because that's the foundation for what happens next. Jesus draws a crowd, of tax collectors and sinners, a crowd of lost people, people who had lost so much in their life that you could just describe them as the lost. Tax collectors and sinners, they lost their reputation. People who had lost everything came to Jesus, and he welcomed them.
He was glad they were there. People who felt like there was no place in society felt like they had a place with Jesus because he welcomed them. And that's the very reason for the next three parables there in Luke 15. Because when Jesus welcomed them, as much as the Pharisees and Sadducees got wrong about Jesus, as much as they totally missed what he was teaching sometimes, they got this. They're scandalized because they understood exactly what Jesus was doing there. He says, they said, this man receives sinners and eats with them. He welcomes them. And, you know, we understand a little bit about what it means to eat with people and what that means about table fellowship. If you go to a restaurant, and maybe some of you, if you remember what it was like to go to a restaurant, right? But when we go eat at a restaurant and they say, you know, they seat you at a table, who sits at your table? Well, the restaurant would tell you it's your party, right? How many in your party? And you might say, oh, you know, we're a family of five, so it's a party of five. Or maybe you're out with friends, and okay, here's our group that we're going to go with. And so they seat your party at the table. What happens if somebody you don't know just walks up and sits down at your table with you? I mean, even before COVID, that was weird, right? You're like, hey, you're not part of our group. You don't belong at our table. You obviously are mistaken. Go sit at your own table somewhere else, right? They're not welcome because they're not one of us. And so we understand a little bit about what table fellowship means. To sit down at a table and eat with somebody means we're in a group together. We identify with each other. You're one of my people. And the Pharisees use this amazing word. When they say Jesus receives sinners, it's an amazing word because the Pharisees and scribes understood what Jesus was doing. The Greek word there is prosdekomai. It means, well, the most common word is to wait expectantly. You know, kind of like what your dog does while you're gone to work and you come home and man, he is so happy to see you and he's been waiting all day just for you to come home. He knows you're coming home. He just doesn't know exactly when. And when you get there, he's so happy. He's been waiting expectantly. That's that same meaning of the word. But it's used in if you're an English scholar or a Greek scholar, either one, it's in the middle voice. What that means is it's personal. I'm doing the action to myself. It means I receive you to myself. So it's really not kind of like your dog waiting for you. It's more like at the holidays when everybody's headed to grandma's and she's watching by the window and she's waiting for you to pull in. And she can't wait, and you get there, and oh, she comes to the door and come in this house, and she hugs you and kisses you, and she's got stuff ready for you. She's been expecting you. And she is so excited that she can welcome you to her house. It's personal. And the Jews got that Jesus really cared about these sinners and tax collectors. And they said, he receives them. Like, he's not just courteous to them. He's excited about them being there. He welcomes them. He's been waiting for them to come see him. He really cares about those lost folks. They got that part. They understood Jesus cares about them. They just didn't get why he cared about them. And so he told them. He said in verse 3, he spoke this parable to them saying, what man of you having 100 sheep, if he loses one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after the one which is lost until he finds it? And when he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, rejoice with me. I found my sheep which was lost. And then Jesus says, here's the point. I say to you that likewise there'll be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 just persons who need no repentance. Jesus tells a story about a rich man. 100 sheep was a lot. If you owned 100 sheep, it meant you were wealthy. And so here's 100 sheep. Here's a rich man and his sheep. And the Jews didn't like shepherds very much. They kind of viewed them as third-class folks. And a rich man would never tend his own sheep. If you could afford to have 100 sheep, you could afford to hire a shepherd. And that's what you would do. You would never go out there yourself. You paid somebody to do that job. And they expected to say that Jesus would say, which of you, if you were so rich you could afford 100 sheep and your shepherds went and lost one of them, which of you wouldn't go and chew out the shepherd and tell him if he doesn't find that sheep or pay for it, he's fired? That's what Jesus would have said does something amazing. He says, which of you, if you have 100 sheep and you lose it? Well, the rich man didn't lose the sheep. The shepherd did. The sheep got itself lost. But Jesus says, this man took responsibility. And in so doing, Jesus says he takes our lostness personally. Jesus is clear. The man who had 100 sheep is the same man that lost one of them, except he didn't. That sheep wandered off, and he would have had a hired hand doing that work anyway. In this culture, you never would have taken responsibility like that. The proper way, in fact, for Jesus to express that would have been another one of those reflexive verbs. It's not the man lost the sheep. You would have said, which one of you, if you have 100 sheep and one of them loses itself? You blame the sheep for getting lost. It's the one that wandered off, after all. That comes over into some other languages. I remember in high school Spanish, learning how to say that I forgot something. It's se me olvidó. It means it forgot itself on me. I didn't forget. That dumb math fact just forgot itself on me right in the middle of the test, and I couldn't answer the question because math forgot itself on me. The shepherd would have blamed the sheep and said the sheep lost himself. Dumb sheep, rebellious sheep, went and got itself lost, wandered off, wasn't paying attention. It's the sheep's fault. But Jesus says the shepherd took responsibility for the sheep, that he feels that lostness personally. The sheep is lost, no doubt, but the shepherd feels the loss. The shepherd says, I've lost something too. That sheep is lost, but I have lost something. And so Jesus is saying to those Pharisees and scribes, of course I eat with tax collectors and sinners. They're lost sheep. What kind of a shepherd wouldn't care about lost sheep? What crazy shepherd would ignore lost sheep? You guys wouldn't do that, would you? You're the Jewish leaders. You know how important sheep are. Each and every one matters. And surely you feel the pain of a lost sheep just like I do. They knew how this was supposed to work. The owner didn't go looking for the lost sheep. He expected his shepherds to do it. Jesus says, I take this lostness personally. And he expects us to do the same. And the shepherd goes to great risk. It says he goes out in the wilderness. He goes to great risk to get the sheep because that lost sheep is valuable. And that's an important message for that one sheep. But it's also important for the other 99, right? There's lots to say about the finding and the work of restoration here too. Jesus talks about 99 people who don't need repentance. But Isaiah says we all, like sheep, have gone astray. And so perhaps when Jesus is talking about those 99 who don't need repentance, he could say they don't need repentance right now. They don't need repentance yet, but they would because we all do eventually. We all need repentance. And it's interesting how Jesus describes repentance, isn't it? Notice what he says. What does this lost sheep do to repent? Repentance in this parable means accepting being found. Jesus says the shepherd goes out and he finds his sheep and he brings it back. And he said that was a process of repentance. Repentance is not us earning our rescue. It's not us saying to God, I'll pay you back. It's not us saying to God, give me a minute, I'll get back on my own. I don't need you to come get me. Repentance begins with the acceptance of being found by God. It doesn't mean there's no work to do. That's not it at all. But God loves you, and it has to start there. The shepherd goes looking for the lost sheep, wanting to bring that sheep back. It has to start there. The next story is about a woman who loses one of her 10 coins. And she feverishly cleans her house looking for the coin which is lost. She knows it's in the house somewhere, and you can't just leave it lost. Those coins are important to her, and when she finds it, she rejoices. Look at what Jesus says. Or what woman having 10 silver coins, if she loses one coin, does not light a lamp and sweep the house and search carefully until she finds it? And when she has found it, she calls her friends and neighbors together, saying, rejoice with me, I've found the piece which I lost. Likewise, I say to you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner land where it's at, they belong together. Somewhere, but they were going to do everything I can to find it. Notice how Jesus begins with 1 out of 100. He moves in this parable to 1 out of 10. In the next parable that we'll look at next week, he talks about 1 out of 2, and by the end of it, he talks about 2 out of 2, because each and every one of us ends up in this position. What's it like to feel lost? Maybe it means feeling forgotten, no longer known. Maybe it feels like being overlooked, no longer visible. Maybe it feels like not belonging anywhere, no longer possessed by anyone, no place to fit in. And along comes Jesus, and he says, let me tell you what God is like. God is the one who sees you and knows you and desires deeply for you to be part of his family. He shows you a God who finds you wherever you are and offers to receive you to himself. He's eagerly expecting that you'll be coming home any minute. He receives, he eats with, he says, you're part of my group, you belong. God loves you. And it all starts there. It doesn't end there, but it all starts right there. And if we don't get that foundation right, nothing else matters. God loves you, period. He takes your loss personally. Wherever you are in your spiritual journey, God loves you. Right where you are. Say, oh no, I got some work to do. I need to clean some stuff up and maybe didn't. God loves you. He loves the lost sheep while it's still in the wilderness. He loves the lost coin while it's still stuck somewhere. And when no one else can see and no one else knows, he sees and he knows and he loves you. And we fight so hard against this. But repentance begins with accepting being found, with allowing yourself to be found instead of lost, with allowing yourself to be identified as, hey, I once was lost, but now I'm found. I once felt unknown, but now I realize I was always known. I once felt invisible, but now I see that God always saw me. And we let go of our identity as a lost one. We let go of our identity of saying, you know what, I'm the guy who made all the mistakes. I'm the guy who made all the failures. And instead we say, I'm the one that God went out to find. God loved me so much. He went to great risk so that I could be found because he loves me that much. We're going to take a few more weeks and we'll look at the next story. It's kind of the big one. And we'll learn a lot from it about what it means to be found. But this morning, the message is really simple. And to start the new year off, it's a great way for us to think about it. Will you allow yourself to be found instead of lost? Will you find your identity in Christ instead of in your mistakes and in your failures? See, I can get up and preach a fire and brimstone-y sermon and talk about sin and how we ought to all be opposed to sin. And we're going to talk some about our disobedience and what it means for us to come back to obedience. We'll do that this year. But if you don't start out with the foundation that God loves you, none of that's going to help. I can guilt trip you into making a decision that'll last for an hour or two, maybe a day. You know, somebody in authority can say, you ought to, and out of respect for their authority, you'll do it for a week or a month. But when you realize how loved you are, and when you fall in love with the God who finds you, that's a lifetime service. And when you have that foundation, everything else falls into place. So let me ask you this morning, do you know that God loves you? There's a great journey, and we'll take it together, following God. We've already sung about it. Where he leads, I'll follow. We'll go there together. We'll walk together as we follow God. But it all starts with the knowledge that God loves you. And maybe this morning, you've never accepted that simple love of God that just says he loves me, period. That's how you understand grace, by the way. It starts out by just knowing God loves me. What are you going to do about that? You see, that's the right time to ask it. It's not what I have to do. And when the God finds me, he says, this is how you stay found. This is how you stay in my group. This is what it means to be part of my people, my set, my flock. Well, yeah, I'm going to repent of my sins. I'm so sorry I ever wandered off. When I understand the shepherd's love, I don't ever want to leave again. I'll repent of my sins. I'll confess my faith. I'll let everybody know Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He sent him to die for my sins. The shepherd came looking for me. I once was lost. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I'll confess my faith. And I'll be baptized. I'll do whatever he asks. I'll be marked. I'll be identified. Hey, I'm in the in group. I'm part of the family of God. I've been baptized to have my sins washed away. God's added me to his church. He added me to his family. He adopted me as his son, and we'll look some more at that next week. Maybe this morning it's time for you to make that commitment, to respond to God's love and become a Christian. Perhaps you're a child of God. You made that commitment. Somewhere along the way, though, you began to feel lost, invisible, unknown, not belonging anywhere. And maybe this morning as we talked, you realize God loves me. He loves me and he wants me to come home and he is eagerly waiting to receive me to himself. And this morning you say, I want to come home. I want to repent. I want to be restored and renewed. I want to be back where I belong. I want to be seen and known and loved and in the place that God wants me to be. If you need to come to the Lord or you need to come back to him, the invitation is open. If we can help you in any way, won't you come right now as we stand and sing?
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid, I think I've lost my way.
Father in heaven, we are thankful that we've been able to be together here this morning for this time to worship you, and we pray that we've been edified by being here together, and we're mindful of those who are not with us. We know many are home, and many are shut in. We want to always remember them and be attentive to their needs. We're thankful for good health, and we know there are those who would enjoy a better portion of good health, and we just pray if it be your will that would happen. We're so thankful for all the blessings of life that you provide for us. We know that you love us and care for us, and we pray that you'll continue to give us the things we're in need of. We're especially thankful for the blessings of Christ and that promise of heaven. We look forward to a home in heaven when this life is over. It's our prayer in Christ's name. Amen.